Remember when bullying stayed at the playgrounds? Kids would go home and then they were free to be who they were. Well, with social media, bullying continues far after everybody's left the school grounds. Social media is one of those detriments. 1.1 million people in Canada alone have been cyberbullied or cyber-stalked. Jonathan MCKEE, our guest today, says this is an important topic, probably one of the most important topics he's ever written about. Thanks for coming back.
Hey, glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
So you did a study.
Yeah.
And you studied bullies.
Yeah.
People that were bullied as well as bystanders. What did you find?
You know, it was interesting. As I went to start the study, my thought was, how can we help these kids who are picked on? But the more I started interviewing young people, I found that there's really three types of young people out there that are dealing with this bullying epidemic. And it's just, you know, not only the kid being bullied, but also the bully. And then the bystander, the people that are kind of caught in the, do I laugh? You know, do I, you know, stand up and say something, or what do I do? And the thing I found is that all three groups really are struggling and really could use some help from moms, dads, and teachers. So I ended up more focusing on the book, just saying, hey, we're not, this isn't just to help kids who are bullied, but I tell you, there's nobody with lower self-esteem than a bully,
yeah.
You know, who is literally trying to raise themselves up by making other people feel lower. So this is an important topic, and especially now that we've got these devices in our pocket that connect us 24/7 and put us basically constantly in front of an audience. Everything we do, everything we post is now rated. It's either liked or not and commented about. And so bullying is now 24/7. Mm. And it's a tough world for young people to grow up in.
Yeah, you'd share your story of being bullied. What do you think, you alluded to it, the fact that now we have social media. If there was social media back when you were being bullied, what do you think would have happened?
Well, the scary thing is, I mean, you and I probably maybe experienced, you know, teasing or tough times. Everybody has tough times at the time, but at least when that bell rang after school, you know, we could go home and for a lot of people go to a safe place at least till the next morning at 7:30 in the morning. But now, as soon as young people leave that campus, they enter a whole new world, the world that they carry there in their pocket. And in that world, you know, they're walking around with this real-time self-esteem barometer that basically tells them exactly how liked they are, you know, exactly how they're doing at that very moment. And you can always find somebody more popular than you. You can always find somebody whose post is going more viral than yours. And that's why we're seeing unprecedented amounts of anxiety and depression. Teen suicide among teenage girls is an all-time high right now. And it's because a lot of them, I think there's this comparison going on. With bullying specifically, it's tough because now we have kids that don't feel good about themselves, and on social media, they have an opportunity to even anonymously jump in and just ridicule people with no accountability. Yeah. So it's a tough world our kids are growing up in.
I thought it was fascinating. In your book, you said that when you were talking to some young people, they wouldn't consider what we would consider cyberbullying as cyberbullying. So, like, they just think, when I post something online, I'm gonna get comments, I'm gonna get haters, I'm gonna get people that like me, but they wouldn't really consider it bullying.
Yeah, for them, it's kind of real life. And if they think about it, they know it hurts, they know they don't like it, but they're like, hate is gonna hate. You know what I mean? This is the world we live in. And it's sad, but they know if there's a YouTube, you know, on there, it doesn't matter how good of a singer they are, somebody's gonna be like, you sound like a dying whale.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this is just the reality we live in. And so they realize that, but it's not like they're immune to it. It's definitely affecting them. Because like I said, we're seeing the numbers going up on the depression and the anxiety and everything. So it's the norm for them, but they don't necessarily like that norm.
Tell me Mallory's story. As I read her story in your book, I thought, it just hit me, because here's a young girl just looking for acceptance.
Yeah, it's a true story about a young girl in New Jersey, 12 years old, who was, you know, dealing with bullying, and the parents, the poor parents, didn't know what to do. And, you know, well, let's go talk with the principal. And she's all, no, that's just gonna make it worse. And we see this again and again. And in so many of the different interviews I did with young people who are experiencing bullying, we saw that with, don't say anything, you're gonna make it worse. Literally, some of these stories, when the principal, they would meet with the principal, moments later, all of a sudden in the bathroom, there's to be some girls saying, we heard you told the principal, and if you do it again, you're gonna get it. I mean, this stuff happens all the time. And with this young girl, she was being so blasted on social media, she took her own life.
At 12.
12 years old.
Yeah.
And this is a tough one for parents because there's this pressure, and you know, I mean, your kid is 12.
He's 12, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And you know, when Ethan comes up to you and says, all my friends have cell phones, my friends are on Snapchat, my friends are on Instagram, you know, and you know that for them to be on Snapchat or Instagram or TikTok or any of these things, they're asked that question, enter your birth date, and if you're under 13, you have to lie about your age. Mm-hmm. So the crazy thing is, and the one thing I tell parents all the time is, guess what? Your kids aren't even supposed to be on social media, you know? So, but yet we hear all these stories of 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds, 12-year-olds being blasted on social media, and they're not even supposed to be on it. So that's one thing parents can do. They can kind of save that pain, or I should say at least delay that pain a little bit. And believe it or not, you know, when our kids are 14 or 16, they're a little more mature and a little more equipped to deal with this than a 10 or 11-year-old who's basically on display, like they're walking around like an 80s celebrity with cameras always on them. And that's the way life is on social media.
Okay, so many more questions, but we're going to take a quick break. We will return with more with Jonathan MCKEE. Stay with us.